Welcome to PixelTunes Radio, a podcast where we have fun talking about video games and video game music. I am Mike.
I'm Ed.
And we don't have any funny names today. Normally we have some funny
names. No, I'm not Samurai Ed.
You are not Ninja.
Wee Lass Ed.
Wee Lass Ed, Little Girl Ninja Ed. I don't know. This is very, you're very boring today.
It's okay because we have a fabulous guest with us.
Yes, we do.
So, you want to introduce him?
I would be glad to, yes.
Go
be honored and treasured and giddy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, I think you just peed yourself.
A little bit, yeah. So, we have a buddy of mine, ours, I guess you could say, yeah. His name is Matt Ezero, but most people on the internet know him as Cygnus Destroyer, a.k.a. the LJN Defender. He also does a series called Innocent Until Proven Guilty, but he's going to go ahead and tell you more about that. Matt, why don't you say hello to the PixelTunes guests?
Hey, everybody. How's it going?
We are awesome.
Yes.
Awesome.
We are doing well. All of us.
So, yes. Matt, why don't you tell us a little bit about your YouTube channel and what you do?
Sure. I started in late 2012. I started with Cygnus Destroyer's Retro Reviews. That was just, you know, and I still do that show. It's just pretty much a jack of all trades, anything and everything retro. But over the course of doing that, I kind of found my niche, if you will, by, like, I've been told that I'm really soft on a lot of games, you know, that people consider to be crappy. So eventually, like, at the end of my first year, I came up with the idea that I was like, you know, I like these LJN games, you know, like, I've always had a fondness for them, and I know they have this reputation, so nobody's sticking up for these games, so why don't I do that? And that's how the LJN Defender was born, and that's how I got a whole bunch of hate my way, but hey, you know, whatever.
But it's so true, because, I mean, I've listened or watched your videos, and you come at games from an entirely different direction than other people mm-hmm. do. And a lot of these games, they really don't get any positive feedback whatsoever.
Oh, absolutely.
So it's just, you know, and I'll go back and play those LJN games after I watch your videos,
yeah.
And I'm like, okay, wow, I'm not playing these with, like, a dark cloud over my head. Like, I'm expecting it to be bad. I kind of give it a more of a fair shake.
Yep.
And I really end up enjoying them more.
I think the big thing about your reviews, specifically with LJN Defender, is you're kind of shining a different light on games that I know you're a big fan of AVGN, a big angry video game.
Oh, yeah, number one influence.
Nerd. A lot of the games that you reviewed, he's also reviewed, and
yep.
you know, I've seen a lot of unfortunate comments, like a lot of negative comments on your channel where people
are
like, oh, this guy's just ripping off AVGN, but you're really not, because you're looking at the games completely different than what he did, you know?
Yeah, and I've gotten, like, AVGN clone before. I'm like, how is what I'm doing an AVGN clone?
Crazy.
If I was an AVGN clone, I'd be drinking Rollin' Rock and taking...
Right.
on the games and all that stuff, you know, but I'm not doing any of that.
Right. I mean, your shows have, like, original thoughts and processes behind them, and on top of that, really in-depth reviews, too, like, mm-hmm. really detailed in-depth reviews. I would say even more so than AVGN, to be honest with you, just because I think that the thought that you put into the reviews and the time that you put into the reviews, you're really kind of ripping everything out of these games, and you're, like, getting very detailed, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Yeah. So, and then you also have that Innocent Until Proven Guilty show. Tell us about that.
Well, that pretty much just started as just an LJN Defender spinoff. In fact, originally it was going to be just, like, because I wanted to cover these games that were considered to be bad that weren't LJN, and it was going to be just, like, originally just, the Bandai Defender, or, you know, whatever, the Mindscape Defender, the Color Dreams Defender, whatever.
Right.
And I was like, no, that's kind of boring. I was like, these games don't get, like, a fair review. So then I came up with the metaphor, it's like, the fair review, like a fair trial, and I would be giving, you know, be fair and impartial, and I would be the jury and judge, and just consider for myself, I mean, not that that's, you know, definitively what these games are, but in my opinion, what these games are. So just, yeah, give these games a fair shake that they haven't been given up to now.
Yeah, no, I think you do a good job with, like, making it so that you can look at a review for a game with a fresh perspective and, you know,
Thanks.
Really dive deep into the game, so that way you can get a feel for it. And so you've picked 12 tracks, which is what we normally go with, 12 tracks of various different games, a lot of which you've actually reviewed. So if you guys like the music in these games, definitely check out Matt's reviews. We'll obviously post a link so you can take a look. So you'll see that on the Facebook group. You'll see that on the YouTube channel, on my YouTube channel. And Matt's actually been in one of my reviews, too. He was in the For a dude you haven't played this game, he was in the Spider-Man
Arcade's
X-Men.
Revenge. Yep.
Yes, Arcade's Revenge episode, which was a lot of fun to put
It was a lot of fun.
Yes,
yeah.
It was.
One of the best soundtracks ever, too.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And, of course, as we go through the show, when Matt has done a review of these titles, we'll definitely mention it so you guys can go check that out.
Absolutely.
So that's going to bring us to our first track of the day. And this is the Player One theme from WWF WrestleMania Challenge from one of our favorite composers, Dave Wise. So, Matt, why did you pick this track?
Well, I just actually reviewed this game, so there's the first one for you.
Yeah.
Huge fan of David Wise, like we all are. Yeah. And I could have gone with so many different choices, but like I said, because I just reviewed this, this song was pretty fresh in my head still. So I was like, yeah, let's go with that one. I mean, it's a great energetic tune, and it really gets you pumped for the action ahead and all the wrestling and whatnot. So yeah, great, great composition.
No, I agree. I think this is a really energetic track. It's a lot of fun to listen to. It just reeks of LJN sound. And I know David Wise did a lot of the LJN games, or at least the LJN published games.
He did quite a few, yeah.
Yeah, like
pretty much all the rare ones.
Right, like I think Nightmare on Elm Street. Well, David Wise was, of course, exclusive to Rare, so when LJN published some of these games, just David Wise just really knocked it out of the park.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I think it sounds like Battletoads meets Captain Skyhawk.
Definitely. Nightmare on Elm Street. Anytime I hear a track that sounds like Nightmare on Elm Street, I'm like, oh, David Wise must have wrote this. And I'm usually right. So it's really good. I wouldn't really place it in any specific genre. Like, I wouldn't really say it's rock. I wouldn't really say it's funk. I wouldn't really say it's, like, dance.
It's pretty much a nice mixture, really.
And now, as far as this game, this is a WWF WrestleMania game. Mm-hmm. It's just one of the very many WrestleMania games that came out on the Nintendo. So with this one, you get to play as yourself. And so now the other ones, like, I know you reviewed like a bunch of WrestleMania games in this review. It was WrestleMania Challenge. It was the WrestleMania game, if I recall, like the the regular.
Yeah, I briefly touched on that. Yeah.
Yep. And then it was Steel Cage Challenge. Was that?
And King of the Ring.
And did David Wise do the soundtracks for all those?
No, he did just WrestleMania and WrestleMania Challenge.
Okay. Yeah, I remember with WrestleMania, that was the one that I played quite a bit when I was younger. Hmm. And, I mean, I was big into WrestleMania, like, back when I was a kid, and then I got really into it again when I was in high school. But then I kind of, you know, I just was like, whatever.
I was a big wrestling fan, too, like, in the 80s and early 90s.
Yep.
And after that, like, around the mid-90s, that's when I got out of it.
Yeah, the last time I watched WrestleMania was, or, like, any of those, like, wrestling shows was definitely, like, the Attitude Era.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like, yeah, like, that was pretty much it for me.
Yeah.
Just a little bit after that, like, right around 2000, I was out of it.
Right.
And Mike and I have the benefit of living in Connecticut, so we got to see, like, so many shows around here.
Yep.
So
there you go.
Closest I got was fourth row seats.
I think it's still, you know, really big for kids nowadays, and I think, you know, there's also obviously adult fans, but I'm not one of them. But some of these games are really still really fun to go back and play.
Yeah, except in this one, I think all the wrestlers walk around like they're toddlers that really have to go to the bathroom.
Yeah, this one and the first one, too.
They're a little bit awkward. Yeah. I really liked, what was it, pro wrestling for the
pro
NES?
Wrestling?
Oh, yeah. The guy with the star on his face.
Is that Starman? Is that a winner is you?
Yep,
yes.
That's the one.
That was fun. My brother and I used to play that all the time.
Yeah, that's a great game.
All right, well, let's get into the music. This is WWF WrestleMania Challenge for the NES from David Wise, the Player One theme. Enjoy. Thank you.
welcome back. That was Bloody Wolf.
Headbanging again.
Oh yeah, stage one, that track. Oh, yeah. And that was on the TurboGrafx-16, a very underplayed system,
yeah,
I would say, musically.
Yeah, we don't musically. Play enough TurboGrafx-16 stuff.
No.
We need to do a show on the TG-16.
On the TG.
Well then, I'm glad I could get you guys started on that.
Yeah,
right now.
No, I think this is one of the first TurboGrafx tracks we've played, other than like Yees.
Other than Yees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah.
Oh, this is not good.
No.
We need to definitely step up our cue cards here.
Seriously.
Come on.
I mean, crap, Rando of Blood.
The amazing Rando of Blood.
So, Bloody Wolf Stage 1, I mean, it's just such an iconic track, really just headbanging.
Oh, yeah, totally rocking.
Just those drums, like the... It's just so militant and awesome. And
you touched on this game a little bit, Matt, during your TurboGrafx.
Yep, just briefly. Yep. I love that game.
Yeah.
In fact, of the games that I own, I would say that it's probably my favorite. That and Splatterhouse. It's close between those two.
Definitely Splatterhouse.
But I think I'd give the edge to Bloody Wolf.
Yeah, Bloody Wolf is fun. I was just talking about during the break how you can name your characters. And I would always name my main guy Mike, because that's my name. And then I would name my second guy T-Bell after Taco Bell. I don't know why. I just like Taco Bell. And I think that he was bald.
Nothing wrong with that.
He was like Taco Bell, like reincarnated as a bald militant dude.
And you'd want to protect him.
Yes. Because you love Taco Bell so much.
Right.
Well, no.
Of course you do.
So Mike gets captured. So the first character that you play as in Bloody Wolf gets captured.
After you rescue the president.
Yeah.
And that's like one of the most intense part of the game, because like the big bad guy shoots this like laser at you and it nullifies all your weapons, so you can only take him out with the knife.
Yeah,
nice.
It's just crazy.
Yeah. It's definitely like Contra on speed. It's really cool. You save the president and then your character gets captured, and then your second character comes in. So basically Taco Bell is out to rescue me.
I gotcha.
Yep.
From the forces of evil.
Taco Bell's saving Mike.
Taco Bell is saving me. Yeah.
That's excellent.
It's a little weird. I'm okay with it.
There's like some kind of metaphor there.
Yeah, no, there's gotta be some kind of metaphor there.
Yeah.
It's one of those dreams where Mike wakes up and his bed's messy.
Yeah, yeah. I've just got like Taco Bell like rubbed all over me. I'm just like, my girlfriend wakes up, she's like, oh, not again.
Why do I smell Taco?
Why do I still smell Cinnabon?
So as far as the soundtrack goes, pretty metal soundtrack.
Yeah.
I think the level 3 soundtrack is one of my favorites, because it's just like, it's pure punk.
Yeah.
And it sounds really, really cool.
It's a pretty eclectic soundtrack. Everything stays in the rock genre, but I think there's some surf rock type stuff there too.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah, it's like surf rock, there's a little bit of rockabilly.
Yes, and that makes sense, because Shogo Sakai worked on this game, who also worked on Mother 3 and a lot of the Kirby titles. And if you're familiar with the Mother 3 soundtrack, there's a ton of rockabilly, there's a ton of surf rock, a ton of that really twangy, guitar-driven style stuff. So I'm sure a lot of the tracks that have that sound in this game were probably from him. Who were the other composers worked on this one?
Yeah, there were two other composers other than Shogo Sakai. Yuji Suzuki and Yusuke Takahama. And so both of these guys are pretty much mostly Data East guys. Yuji Suzuki worked on Cobra Command, which I've never played, Bad Dudes on NES, RoboCop on NES, which I love the RoboCop NES soundtrack, Glory of Hercules, which was a Famicom game, Heavy Barrel for Nintendo, Boulder Dash for Nintendo.
Nice.
His last soundtrack was actually Operation Logic Bomb, the ultimate search and destroy for the Super Nintendo, which I reviewed previously.
Right.
Yes. And then Yusuke Takahama also worked on Bad Dudes for Nintendo and Heavy Barrel, Boulder Dash. He also did Side Pocket on the Game Boy. Werewolf the Last Warrior, which is a really obscure...
Oh, I love that.
Yeah, it's a great soundtrack.
A really good rock-based soundtrack.
Future review.
Yeah.
Definite future. I've been wanting to do that one for a long time.
Yeah.
So sooner or later, that's going to
happen. That'll be a good one.
I actually sat down fairly recently and tried to play through that game, and it was just too hard. I was thinking about reviewing it myself, and I just couldn't get that far in it. And
It's definitely a difficult game.
It is definitely really hard. He also did Caveman Ninja, which was the arcade version of the Joe and Mac games. It's weird. He didn't really work on the NES versions or the Super NES versions, but he did do the Genesis version, which that's interesting.
That's strange.
Worked on some stuff for the Sharp X68000, such as Scorpius. and worked on Kickmaster for the Nintendo, which that is a great...
it's another great game,
really
yeah.
great underrated gem
really,
for Nintendo.
Totally underrated.
Yeah, did F1 Pole Position for Game Boy. I mean, he's kind of been all over the place. And of course, worked on Super Smash Brothers Brawl.
Of course. And he also did Rivet King. Have either of you guys played Rivet King?
I have not.
I have not either.
That is so much fun.
Is it really?
It's like mini golf, but okay. you're in this huge obstacle course. Mm. You have a frog. And you have a hammer.
Okay.
And you basically like...
I already like where this is going.
You the frog is basically on like a slingshot kind of deal.
Okay.
And you pound it with the hammer and the frog slings itself into the obstacle course. And then it hops and then there's different things that like pick it up. And it's, so it's almost played like golf where you have to basically get your frog to jump into the hole before the other person does. But along the way, there's like obstacles and stunts. And the more stunts you make the frog do, the more points you get.
Hmm.
So you kind of compete against another person to get into the hole either faster... or to like get the most stunts on the way there. So there's
right.
like water they can swim through, and every stroke they swim, you get points for it.
Huh.
It's really a lot of fun. The soundtrack is really good too. So
yeah, that's on
the
interesting.
GameCube and PS2.
GameCube and PS2.
Yeah,
right.
definitely
yeah.
a worthwhile purchase. I've had tons of fun playing that one.
I will have to check it out. I'm still looking for
yeah.
Silent Hill, Shattered Memories. The one you recommended.
Oh yeah.
For the Wii.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm still hunting that one. That
really
one.
Is that hard to find.
You know, I've actually never played a single Silent Hill.
Oh no.
No, Matt.
Nope. Not one. Nope.
this is unacceptable.
Oh man.
One of my favorite series of all time.
You just broke it, sorry.
yeah.
There.
Yeah, that started on like the PS2, right?
Yeah,
PlayStation 1 was
PS1.
The first one.
Okay, maybe I was out of it because like around the PS2 era is when I got out of gaming. So if it's like later PS1, that's pretty much around the same time
yeah.
too
and
for me. So
that
pretty much explains it.
None of the games are. You don't have to play the first ones to play like the
right.
second, third, or fourth.
Yeah,
so you
no
can pretty
like,
much jump in wherever you want.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
really nice.
1 and 3 are kind of connected,
sort
but
of.
Not so much that you'd need to play 1 to
right.
play 3. So, anyways,
yeah.
I figured I'd ask. So what you had mentioned that you got out of gaming, was it just, you know, because I noticed that most of the tracks that you've picked today are all from pre PlayStation 1 era, pre N64 era, all that stuff. Is it just, you know, you kind of live in the nostalgia, you like the, you know, NES and Super NES stuff? Because I notice you typically do reviews on that type of stuff. Is that just because that...
Yeah, that's my favorite generation
right.
for sure.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, the last, like, generation that I really kept up with, and it's only, like, kind of, was PS1, and I had... N64, I had a few games for N64,
right.
but yeah, after that, you know, I completely missed GameCube,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Dreamcast, you know,
mm-hmm.
PS2, yeah, all that generation, yeah.
Is this something where you think you'd go back maybe in 10 years or in 5 years and be like, oh, let me check this out?
I've actually started to, because I do have a GameCube and a PS2
oh, okay.
now, and I'm building up my library, so yeah, I have, you know, played some of those games now, and there's some good stuff there that I definitely missed out on.
Yeah, that's the one thing I will say, and I'll probably end up eventually getting a PS3 because I skipped out on the PlayStation 3. My big thing is I won't buy a system, like a console, unless I have at least 5 games that I know.
5 must-buys?
Like 5 must-buys. I think that Tecmo just sold me on a PS4.
Oh, the Final Fantasy Dissidia fighting game?
Final Fantasy, listen, you combine Final Fantasy and Tecmo... Okay.
And fighting.
And Tifa.
And Team Ninja.
And Team Ninja. And I think you know where I'm going with this. So they may have sold me a PS4 in a couple years. Anyways.
Jiggle physics for the win.
Yes. Tifa jiggle
Tifa
physics.
Tifa jiggle physics.
For the win. And you know what? My buddy Jimmy Hoppa will back me up on
and
that.
And it won't be tacos.
Oh, I know he would. I definitely know he
yes,
would.
Yes, he would. All right. So moving on. As always, getting sidetracked. Our next track is from Bubsy. Now, you picked the Super Nintendo version.
I did.
This is the title screen music, also called War of the Woolies.
Yes.
I didn't even know.
Yes.
Oh, that's funny.
And this track was composed by Matt Berardo.
Yes. The Woolies are the enemies that you fight
right.
throughout the
okay.
game. This game, for me, has... It's kind of a weird nostalgia thing because
okay. mm-hmm.
at one of the local malls, they had one of these traveling video game tours.
Okay.
And it was just before Bubsy had came out. And the whole thing was, I think it was kind of sponsored by Accolade because
okay.
I still have flyers from it that have like Accolade's logo all over.
Wow.
So I got to play Bubsy before it actually came out, like
okay.
in the mall. And I remember really, really loving it. And so, you know, obviously they it did its job, because as soon as Bubsy came out, it went out and then I bought it. And then, I don't know, I brought it home and I was like, wow, this game is not the hype that they were giving it up to be.
Yeah, but you played it.
I did, and it was, but, you know, it's like it's
brand new.
Did they
change it up between then?
When you're like 12 years old and you're playing games that haven't come out and, you know, you're surrounded by all this Bubsy stuff and you kind of feed into that, so.
So you're telling me that.
I mean, I played it and I played it all the way through and I did enjoy it, but I'm saying the hype for the game didn't match my expectations.
Are you telling me that you were a victim of Bubsy hype?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
All right then.
But the soundtrack is fantastic.
At least you admit it.
Yeah, so
it absolutely
is. What are your thoughts on the game, Matt? I'm curious.
I like, I mean, it's not a great game or anything, but I mean, of course, anybody would probably, who's watched my videos on my channel, knows that I would like that game. But yeah, I mean, I enjoy it for what it is. I mean, it's a pretty decent platformer, and as far as like the animal mascot type of games go, it's one of the better ones, I think. But yeah, the soundtrack is really the star of that game for me.
Yeah.
I just love that title theme, especially. It's got like a really jazzy kind of feel to it. I love the tone. It just, I think I only rented the game I don't think I rented twice, but yeah, it's just very nostalgic for me. You know, I know for a fact that I owned Bubsy 3D. And
I'm so sorry. Enough, no wonder you stopped the PS1 era.
Right.
Yeah.
You completely skipped over Mario 64.
Oddly enough, I don't remember thinking that it was horrible back then, so I don't know, you know? So I guess I was always destined to be the guy who likes crappy
games.
It's
in your genetics.
Yep, exactly.
You were a victim of Bubsy hype as well.
Yes.
Bubsy,
yes,
3D
I
was.
Bubsy 3D hype.
Yes.
So, yeah, so War of the Woolies. So tell me about Matt Berardo.
He hasn't done too much.
No.
He has mostly done composition for just a few games. Mainly, he was in the industry between 1990 and 1995. He started off with Joe Montana Football and F-14 Tomcat in 1990.
So very American games.
Oh, yeah. He did Sim Ant, Ultimate Air Combat. Then he did Bubsy after that, and then after that did the remake of Lode Runner, The Legend Returns. He did Mario's Game Gallery, which, that title doesn't sound familiar to me.
That's a Game Boy title, isn't it?
This game was released for DOS, Mac, and Windows.
Oh.
Huh.
And it was Dominoes, Backgammon, and Poker. You could play poker
that,
with Mario.
You know what? That, I think, is the first game that has Charles Martinet as Mario.
Really?
I recall.
Oh, wow.
I believe that's the case.
It was published by Interplay.
I'm almost positive.
I'll have to read up more on that. That's pretty cool.
Interesting.
That is.
Yeah, voice of Mario, Charles Martinet.
Yeah.
Really neat.
Wow.
That's a historical first.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
After Mario's crazy Charles Martinet adventure, he did an online version of Lode Runner and then did the music conversion when they re-released the Alone in the Dark trilogy in 1995.
Okay.
So that's pretty much it. And most of those titles are kind of like laid back, more on the jazzy, bluesy side. So that's pretty much his style. You know, Bubsy's got a whole bunch of different themes in it. So there's like Western theme, and then like the title screen was jazz, and then the first stage is almost like reminds me of Blues Brothers.
Yeah.
It's kind of very upbeat and bluesy. And then there's kind of like a spacey cinematic theme towards the end when you're on the space station. So it's got some good stuff.
I don't know.
It's fun to listen to.
I think Zool the Intergalactic Ninja could defeat Bubsy in a mascot battle.
It's like Battle of the Underdogs.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
He's a ninja.
He'd destroy him with
lollipops?
Yeah, the Chupa Chups.
Yeah, I think it's pronounced Chupa Chups, because I know the Lonely Goomba like referenced them in one of his videos. So I think they come out of the UK, and I know he's in the UK.
Okay.
Yeah. Chupa Chups.
Yeah.
Interesting, we've been pronouncing it wrong.
I also learned...
That's okay.
Interesting fact that Salvador Dali actually designed their logo.
What, Chupa Chups?
Chupa Chups, Chupa Chups, whatever you want to call them.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's get to Bubsy. Title screen music. Again, this song is
Bubsy.
Called War of the Woolies, and this is the Super Nintendo version. Nick Carney, unpopular opinion gamer.
You know what, though? Sonic was the coolest mascot. He had attitude in all the right places. He was super cool and fast.
No way, man. Mario is the king of mascots. Without him, there'd be no Sonic.
Well, hello again, boys. Are you talking about mascots? Bubsy was so misunderstood. His 3D game was a bit repetitive, but I think it was pretty okay.
Ugh, not again.
This guy, you know, I get a feeling he just likes unpopular games for the heck of it.
Now, gentlemen, I am a fan of all the popular games, too, you know.
Oh, yeah? Well, name one.
Yeah.
E.T. for the 2600.
Oh, come on.
I knew it.
Okay, then how about Bugs Bunny's Birthday Blowout?
Wrong.
Wait, hold up, I like that game.
Dude.
What?
That game sucks.
No way.
Come on, it was like a ripoff of Mario Brothers 2.
No way. No, dude, the music was really good.
The music was okay, but look, you couldn't even control your guy. It was just flopping all over the place.
Yeah, but the controls were tight. I mean, the game was fun. It had cool locales.
It was like Kemco. What did Kemco do?
Yeah, Kemco's okay.
Kemco doesn't even have a name in the shots of business anymore.
Victory!
Looks like another wacky adventure for
Nick Carney, unpopular opinion gamer.
Welcome back. That was Deja Vu. And I feel like I've been here before.
Yeah. I feel like you've said that before.
Yeah.
I feel like Matt's been on this show before.
No, Matt's never been on this show. He's been on
other
shows.
Okay, it must just be Deja Vu.
He's been on other shows on this channel, but not
this
show.
Yes.
So that song is called Peoria Streets, and that is from the 1990 classic for the Nintendo Entertainment System.
But wait.
What?
Before we get into that.
Yes.
I just wanted to say.
What?
Chupa Chups. Was started in Spain. So it's pronounced Chupa Chups in Spain. However, in the UK, they pronounce it Chupa Chups.
There you go.
So
and
we're
chupar
both right.
Chupar means, yes, chupar means to lick in Spanish. So the lollipop's English translation would be licky licks.
Licky licks.
Now back to our regularly scheduled program.
Yes.
Yes. Purist.
This is brought to you by Chupa Chups and Zool Too.
So this track is just a classic noir, jazz, just like smoky.
Oh my
smoky.
God, I can just see, everything turns to black and white.
Absolutely.
When you listen to this song.
It just oozes like noir, this like smoking gun. It's really great. I mean, I love songs, like jazz songs converted into like NES type stuff or Genesis. In particular, the soundtrack for Side Pocket, if you've ever heard that.
Really good stuff.
Really good jazz oriented soundtrack. Especially on the Genesis, really good on the Genesis. But for Deja Vu, yeah, no, this is a good song to like kind of throw in the background, especially if you got a video where you just like you need some background
music.
Yeah,
I just
really
I just love the tone of it. It has such a great atmosphere, you know.
Yeah,
and Masuno really knows how to manipulate the NES sound hardware.
Oh yeah,
as well,
sure
like using the noise channel like as the brush strokes for the drums and just really toning everything down. The game itself is pretty cool. You know, it's a point-and-click adventure.
Right.
It's in that Kemco trilogy that includes Deja Vu, Shadow Game, and The Uninvited.
Right.
And I remember playing them when I was a kid, and they were like, I guess they were a little bit beyond me. I rented them, so I only had like, you know, 3 or 5 days, however long they let me rent games at that point. But I think I was a little young for them, so I didn't really understand the logic that you needed to solve a lot of the puzzles and stuff, but I still remember the music being really cool and it just being very thick with the atmosphere.
Oh, absolutely.
It really kind of drew you into them.
Yeah, like this song, to me, it's like the perfect soundtrack to like a fall. Like if you're going out on a night walk on like a fall evening, you know, that's like, it's like the perfect soundtrack for that.
I could just picture like Matt wearing like a hoodie and just walking down the street, just like humming this track.
Yeah.
But like really loud, and people are driving by, and they're just like, "What is this?
What the hell's up with that guy?"
Yeah. I got to agree with you with the Deja Vu games and that whole trilogy of shows.
Oh yeah, they all have amazing soundtracks.
Yeah, I mean, like I kind of always ignored these games. I was always kind of like point and click. Mm-hmm. And I was always like, whatever. Like it's not an arcade action beat 'em up type.
Yeah, exactly.
Game. So, I'm sure if I went back now and had played the game, I think I would probably really enjoy it.
I got to a point at my video store, because at that point it wasn't like a major blockbuster or anything, it was just kind of like a mom and pop video store, where I had rented nearly everything that they had. So my brother and I would go in there and we'd be like, because my mom would usually let us rent like two games, because there were two of us. So
yeah, yeah.
So we would like double up and, you know, rent two games at a time.
Nice.
And we were getting down to the dregs. It was like, well, this one looks okay. There's a guy looking around a corner on the cover. Okay, I guess I'll just take this one.
I guess you just look around corners in this game.
Well, yeah, that's neat because I got to try out a lot of the games that I wouldn't have normally played back then.
Right.
So a lot of the kind of obscure games that I love now.
Isn't that like
there,
a great
like,
thing if I... back then, that's like totally gone now. All you had to judge a game by really was like box art, or maybe like if it was in Nintendo Power or EGM or a magazine like that, you know.
No,
but now there's
totally
like coverage everywhere, like, you know, everything's like spoiled like months in advance.
There's been situations where I got convinced to get a game, like, for example, I really need to pick up a copy of Low G Man, like, I've decided
that's a good one.
I've watched long plays. I talked to our buddy Cameron about the game. He suggested the soundtrack is really good.
Yep.
And I finally sat down, I watched a long play of the video, and I was like, I gotta get this game. Like, I need to own this. So in that circumstance, if I had seen that game in like Nintendo Power, I would have totally passed on it.
Yeah.
But the fact that I saw motion video captured footage of the actual game itself, and I was like, I wanna get this now.
Kind of digressing a little bit, but just from a younger generation's point of view, I've, you know, mentioned how my older son Eddie is really, really into Fallout.
Yeah.
And he's been watching this YouTuber Venturian play like all the way through Fallout, and he'll go through and, you know, does dialogue and commentary over the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think he would have even touched the game if he hadn't seen Venturian playing the game. So now he goes back and he's kind of like playing it alongside him.
Okay.
And having a blast with it, because he doesn't, He like kind of knows where to go, but then he'll go off and do his own stuff too. So I think it's actually enhancing his gameplay experience instead of detracting it.
Sure.
So I guess it's really all about how you use the videos and the information that you have, whether you want it to be a detriment or an advantage to your gameplay experience.
Yeah. All right, so that's Deja Vu. The soundtrack is amazing. The game, you either love it.
The game's like
or
a fine wine. Like, you need to be able to appreciate it.
Right, yeah. Right. So moving on, we're going to get to the next track, which is also by Hiroyuki Masuno, and that is Bugs Bunny's, or sorry, the big, the Bugs Bunny's
the,
birthday blowout.
That, forget that the, that's
yes,
very important.
Very important. Very crucial. And this game came out in 1990 in the United States, and this track that you picked is World 4.
Mm-hmm.
I know you've reviewed this game. Tell us why you picked this track.
I love the mood of it. I mean, it has like a similar, like, it's very ethereal kind of sounding. And it's just, it's kind of like, it's got an like a kind of an odd time signature too. It's kind of like a waltzy kind of.
And
I really dig that. You know, whole soundtrack is really good, but that's the highlight, that one right there.
No, I agree. The whole soundtrack is really excellent. This is actually, I really like this game.
Mm-hmm.
And audio-wise, this particular track has a really great slinking bass line. It's got this really like good traveling slinking bass line.
Oh, it's an amazing bass line.
The whole track kind of feels like dragging in the sense that like you're just being dragged through the mud. Like you're just, I would say it's a bit of a dark track too, which makes sense because the world itself that you're in this part of the game, I think is very,
it's the darkest of the game. Yeah,
it is. That's correct. Yeah. It's like very dark blue, if I recall.
Yes. And it actually goes dark completely at a lot of the times, you know,
that's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
That lead synth almost sounds like Arabian.
Yeah, a little bit.
Like
the
most depressing parts of like the Aladdin movie or something.
Does the monkey die in Aladdin? I can't.
No, monkey doesn't die.
I was gonna say, that'd be terrible. I have a pretty good personal story. I mentioned this on my, back when I was doing Nest Marie's, which was like a, you know, personal visit to my childhood in gaming. And I haven't done one of those in a really long time. I should start doing them again. But Bugs Bunny Birthday Blowout was a game that I played entirely through Chickenpox. So I had this game, I got it as a gift, and I actually sat down and played through it while basically, I don't know why, but I was eating like a lot of ice pops at the time, like those
multi-hydrated, I guess.
Yeah, no, I guess. I have no idea. But yeah, I blew through this entire game while having the chicken pox. So constantly itching my skin, even though I wasn't supposed to. And
it's funny.
Yeah. So it was funny because it's like a lot of people think that this, especially, you know, watching, again, as we said before, the AVGN review, the Angry Video Game Nerd, and people just hate this game, and I never hated this game. I always loved it.
No, same here. I've always loved this game.
It was always a lot of fun. I was the type of person that would kill every enemy, too. Like, I would have to kill every enemy, and I would have to break every single block. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, you know, you got to use that hammer, you know. You can't let that go to waste, you know.
So tell me about Hiroyuki Masuno.
Hiroyuki Masuno?
Masuno, sorry.
Well, he mainly worked for Kemco.
Right.
And then he left Kemco and ended up working for Compile. So he started off in 1986 with Spy vs. Spy on the NES.
Okay.
So that really kind of...
Which is, like, my least favorite of his work. Of the song, of the soundtracks of his that I have heard, that's like my least favorite. But I know that's not his fault, since he's just... that wasn't his composition. He's just working with what was already pre-established.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right. On, like, the Atari or whatever, you know, previous system was on.
He had a lot of Famicom games. He actually did the sequel to Spy vs. Spy called Spy vs. Spy Island Caper, which only came out on the Famicom. As far as more popular U.S. stuff, he did Snoopy's Silly Sports Spectacular.
That's a lot of S's.
Yes.
Syllables. Lots of silly syllables in that one.
Snoopy's Silly Sports Spectacular Show.
So, coincidentally enough, Deja Vu and the Bugs Bunny Crazy Castle were back-to-back. So he did Bugs Bunny Crazy Castle immediately after finishing Deja Vu.
Oh, okay.
And after that went on to Shadowgate, Ghost Lion, which was...
As
RPG.
Famicom RPG, right?
It was released on the Nintendo.
Oh, it did come out here? Okay.
Yeah. Then he converted his music to the Game Boy for the Bugs Bunny Crazy Castle game on the Game Boy. Followed that up with Uninvited.
There were like five of those games that came out, those Crazy Castle games.
Yeah, there were a bunch. Did Rescue the Embassy Mission for the NES.
Which I've reviewed.
Yeah. And then he kind of went back to cartoony stuff a little bit and did Snoopy's Magic Show. He did the Happy Birthday.
Him and that Snoopy, man.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then he did the Happy Birthday Bugs edition of the Bugs Bunny Birthday Blowout for NES. North and South on the NES, which is actually a really fun game.
What's the Happy Birthday version of Bugs Birthday Blowout?
It's Bugs Bunny Birthday Blowout, and in parentheses, Happy Birthday Bugs.
Oh, it's like a completely different...
Or maybe that was the Japanese title of the game?
Maybe.
Maybe. Yeah, because that's... I've never heard of that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll have to look that up.
That'd be interesting if there was like a special edition released.
That would be,
with like a transparent cartridge.
Yeah,
bunny ears that come off the top of it or something.
Yeah, definitely.
Gosh. But anyways, North and South, that was a pretty good game. Okay. It's worth a lot nowadays.
Yes, absolutely.
Draken for the Super Nintendo. He did the sound driver for Top Gear for the Super Nintendo, which was interesting because Barry Leach did that soundtrack.
That's right.
Huh. You don't really often see a Japanese person
do
a sound driver.
That's
actually
one of my favorite racing games. I mean, I'm not a huge fan of racing games, but that's one of my favorites.
Tons of fun. And then he wrote the sound driver for Phalanx on the SNES, which is one of my favorite games and favorite soundtracks.
Good game, good shooter.
Kid Clown in Nightmare World.
Wait, that's the game with the banjo.
Yes, that is the iconic cover.
That's the only thing I remember about that stupid game. Cartridge cover.
The game is good.
Oh, no. The game is good, but the freaking
the cover is awesomely bad, but the game itself is good, though.
It's right up there with Carnage.
I definitely recommend checking that one out.
X-Zone and Top Gear 3000 were the sound drivers for, and his last games for these systems were... He did the remake version of Shadowgate Classic for the Game Boy Color.
Oh, I remember that when they came out.
And then Déjà Vu 1 and 2, the casebooks of Ace Harding for the Game Boy Color. So whether he actually came back to do the music for those or somebody just... imported his music into the Game Boy versions.
Yeah.
Because that was 1999, so who knows if he was still working in the industry at that point. I say it's about time we get into the music.
Bugs Bunny, the Bugs Bunny's birthday blowout. And again, this is World 4.
Thank you.
welcome back to that face melting track right there. That was Tim Follin with Solstice. That was the title screen theme released on 1990 for the NES. Probably one of his most iconic and well-loved tracks, I think.
Oh, absolutely.
This is your 8-bit man crush.
Not just 8-bit, man.
16-bit.
Everything, dude.
Yep. Everything.
Everything.
He's just your man crush.
Yeah, yeah. Musical man.
As far as video game music goes, yeah.
Not that I have other man crushes, but I like him because of his music.
Right.
Well, I don't think he's like sexy or anything like that.
I don't know. I mean, you're you know, you wanted to slip him into your kid's sandwiches.
That's right.
So.
No, you're the one that came up with that. That wasn't me.
Yeah. No, that was totally you. That wasn't me.
I see.
We should go back and listen to that episode again. Okay. What was that, like episode like 5 or
that
something?
That was like a long
four?
Time ago.
That was like when we first started.
We were kids.
We were wee lasses.
we were wee lasses. Little toddlers running around doing podcasts together.
With full beards. full bearded little girls. Irish girls. So, Solstice, never played this game. Tell me about it.
It's an isometric craft fest. I don't know. I didn't enjoy it very much. Yeah. I found it really hard to keep my place on the screen. Mm-hmm. I'm not
really good at this game, and I'm not like a huge fan of this game either, but it's just the soundtrack. I just love the soundtrack.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's amazing, yeah.
There's no shadow under you when you jump.
Yeah.
And it's
really confusing.
Right, especially with the isometric.
And I end up falling a lot of the time. It's like, man.
You end up falling.
I have a hard time finding out where I should go, too. It's like, yes, falling to fallen.
Oh, boy.
But yeah, you have to go through the princess was kidnapped, or it was your girlfriend, or some chick gets kidnapped, as usual.
As usual.
Something like that.
And you have to go and collect, I think, 7 different scrolls, and you're in this gigantic dungeon, and it's pretty much open world. I mean, it's kind of a non-linear game.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know, if you fall down pits, you don't die, you just go to the level that's underneath you.
So it's like Toe Jam and Earl.
Yeah, and it gets really, really confusing to figure out like which floor you're on. Mm-hmm. And the fact that it's isometric and the way it's all laid out makes it very difficult for you to have like maps. You know, so you can't go to like GameFAQs and download a gigantic JPEG of the layout of the world because it's equally as confusing as the game itself is. So it's just really hard to go through. As we were talking about before, this is kind of one of the games that it might be advantageous to have a long play just to kind of go along with, just because it is so hard or so easy to get lost in this game.
Definitely, yeah.
But that title screen music, oh my goodness.
Oh, it's amazing.
It just, you know, it starts off with like that first 9 seconds of doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo, and you're like, okay, this game is going to have crappy music.
Gonna blow chunks.
And then it just blows your ears out.
And then those arpeggios come in. It's like,
all five channels just blast you at once.
Yeah.
And you feel like that guy in those old Memorex commercials with the time.
Yeah, exactly.
And like being blown away by what's on the speakers. Really, really enjoy it.
And we've completely aged
ourselves
right there with that reference.
As if we weren't talking about how old I was before. So
you are an old gentleman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. Let's just rub that in a little bit more, please.
This track is excellent. I really love the just sound of it all. I mean, the major thing is obviously tons of influences from other prog rock bands. Tim Follin always said that he wanted to write tracks that didn't sound like video game music.
Right, it sounded like the stuff that he listened to.
Right, exactly. And so obviously he's a big Deep Purple fan, a big Jethro Tull fan. This track reeks of Tull specifically. So, really good stuff. Mm-hmm. And I love Jethro Tull myself, so I'm on board with this, 100%.
I wonder if Tim Follin's as big of a fan of Tim Follin as I am.
No, I don't think so.
You don't think that's possible?
I don't think he tries to slip himself into your kids, his kids' sandwiches.
Yep. I don't think so. Yeah.
But, you know, we've talked about Tim Follin lots and lots on the show. You know, obviously he's very well known for doing the Silver Surfer
soundtrack. Dude's amazing. One of the best video game composers of all time, for
Solstice,
sure.
Solstice, Silver Surfer, Pictionary, just a few of his...
Yeah, it was tough to pick, like, one, like, I could have gone with so many choices, but I was like, if I was going to introduce somebody to Tim Follin, the genius of Tim Follin, this song right here, because it's got everything that makes him what he is.
It is a good, like, overall, like, hey, do you want to know who Tim Follin is? Boom, Solstice.
Right,
yeah,
right.
No, definitely.
Especially with that intro. I mean, it just, it all goes back to that, because they're going to be like, What?
Oh! Yeah.
You die.
Yes.
Face.
And burn. Then you can follow this up with something ethereal and beautiful, like from the Echo series or the Echo game on Dreamcast. And
right.
It's like two completely different ends of the spectrum, and they're both phenomenally composed. So.
Well, we'll leave that to to your Tim Follin episode, which eventually will come.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Get to it eventually.
But we have another track lined up. That's also a Tim Follin track.
Yes.
Yes.
Back to back Follin.
Yeah, that's right. We're Follin for Follin today. So.
Yes.
So this is from Incredible Crash Dummies. This is going to be our next track. And this track was composed, or the game was released in 1993. This is the Roof Jump theme. And this is in particular the Game Boy version. And it was composed actually apparently by Matt Furness.
From what the internet tells me. Now, I don't know which game Matt Furness wrote these original tunes for.
Okay.
But multiple sources have told me that Matt Furness wrote the original tunes.
Okay.
And then Tim's brother Jeff and Tim himself arranged these tracks
Follin
for the Game Boy version.
Right. So that's supposedly...
Yeah, that's just so strange to me because this sounds so Follin.
Yes.
You know?
Right. Yeah, we were talking about that. It's definitely a very Follin-ish track. And what's really nice is, which you don't hear a lot, like Game Boy has a very distinct sound. Like if you listen to Castlevania II, Belmont's Revenge, like it has that like saw, you know, this.
Yeah, it sounds like it's always sounded like a slightly enhanced NES.
Right. Well, bass in Game Boy in particular has that, either that sawtooth, like.
It's a little grittier.
It's grittier, it's chunkier, it's heavier. Whereas, you know, you listen to this track and you're like, this could have been on the NES.
Yeah.
Like it's that good.
Yep.
And so, you know, Game Boy.
And it was, so.
And it was.
Because I believe, the soundtracks are exactly the same. I'm pretty positive.
Yeah.
The NES and the Game Boy ones.
That would make sense. I mean, I could see, you know, as far as.
And they're both actually the first stages of each respective game. Because, I mean, the NES one is, like, pretty much a standard platformer.
Yeah.
But the Game Boy one is, like, a mini game compilation.
Yeah, I know you mentioned this game in your review.
Yep.
You did
the Super Nintendo
one. The Super Nintendo one.
Yep.
But you had. I believe briefly touched on the fact that
just briefly.
Yeah, and you were kind of like, why didn't they compose the Super Nintendo version? And
it would have been nice.
Who did convert do the Super Nintendo version?
Oh man,
yeah, Peter Stone and Nick Eastridge from Bold Graphic Communication.
There you go.
That's right.
And it had kind of like a more like a hip hoppy kind of a
European
street feel
English
to it.
Like American ish.
Yeah,
I'm just throwing words out. Radish.
Yeah, it's like, what are you talking about?
It's like hot peppers. Like, it sounds like hot peppers on cooking.
Like, sounds like french fries with
french
vinegar
fries
on them.
With mayonnaise. Yeah.
Okay. Mike's tired. So anyways, as far as the gameplay goes, it's like a little collection of mini games. I only played a little bit of it just to kind of get a feel for the game. And I immediately failed on the first level because I'm not thinking like a crash test. Dummy.
Oh, there's your problem.
And
that is
so
the
you
problem.
Jump off this building, and you're supposed to land at the bottom of it, and I'm avoiding all the obstacles.
And you're supposed to hit them.
Well, I'm supposed to hit the obstacles all the way down. So I land, and they're like, fail, you could do better next time. I'm like, what? I didn't touch a thing.
Oh, that's funny.
You're supposed to crash through all the
balconies. Yes, you are.
And go through all the stuff.
You are a terrible crash test dummy.
I guess, you know, that's why I'm not a crash test dummy.
Well, you know what? If they were, because their name is Incredible Crash Test Dummies, so you were a non-incredible crash
test
dummy.
Just a mediocre crash test
dummy. You were a mediocre crash test dummy.
Anyway, so this track is full of the same kinds of arpeggios and really, really catchy hooks that Solstice had. I think it's time to get into the music because I can't wait to listen to it again. So this is the Roof Jump theme from Crash Test Dummies, or Incredible Crash Dummies, on the Game Boy, arranged by Jeff Follin and Tim Follin, originally performed by Matt Furness. Hit it.
album back. That last track was from Terminator for the Sega Genesis.
Yes, not Terminator Genesis, the movie.
No. Yeah.
Terminator on the Genesis, the console.
And that was from Level 1, and the track was called Holocaust.
Holocaust.
Mm-hmm. Which is not no bueno. I don't like that name.
Well, being Jewish, yes, I can understand why you would be upset about that.
Yeah, a little bit.
But it's not the...
But it's not right.
Not that Holocaust.
No, it's from, you know, the massive human genocide that goes on in the Terminator movies.
Yep, so. With the rise of the machines.
That is
Skynet,
correct.
All that stuff. Judgment Day.
Hey, Skynet's still happening, man.
So it's an equally horrible Holocaust, just a fictional one.
Yeah. And this track was composed by Matt Furness, who we've talked about quite a bit on the show.
Speak of the devil.
Speak of the...
Mm-hmm.
The... Recording devil.
And if you're listening, Matt Furness. Hi, Matt Furness.
I don't know. He's done some really good stuff.
Oh, yeah. You said that in the last one, that he was in contact with you guys, right?
Like, yeah, the episode. He basically was like, hey, yeah, no, I worked on this track. He confirmed for us basically about the
Mortal Kombat
track,
awesome.
Which was really good track, yeah. So here we have another very bass-heavy track. As far as this, it very like driving bass.
Yeah, this exactly. one I think, this one doesn't get a lot of the accolades that I think some of Matt Furness's other soundtracks, and I will always kind of wonder why.
Yeah. Like
and,
every tune is great.
Yeah, but I think one of the reasons why it gets overlooked by some people is because the sound effects and the game itself are so loud and overbearing that it's... Sometimes the soundtrack gets really buried underneath it.
That's a shame.
But listening to it by itself, I mean, it's got those really unique note bends where the keyboards kind of like sweep up at the end of every long note. It's just really cool sounding.
But yeah, this song stuck with me for years. I rented this game once when I was a kid. And like all these years, that song stuck with me. I just really couldn't remember what game it was. I thought it was Terminator, but then like a couple years back, I bought the Terminator for Genesis thinking it might be that, and it was. And that's why, like my Willie Beamish review, that I used this tune on the intro of that video. Because I was like, yeah, I love this song. Gotta use this song.
Yeah, this game I don't have any experience with itself. I mean, the only Terminator game that I played, you know, for the first Terminator movie was the Sega CD one, which I was talking about. Mm-hmm. Right before the break, and that is to me the definitive Terminator experience as far as a video game goes. Like, I don't think there's any better Terminator game than that, other than maybe like T2, the arcade game.
That was so much fun.
Yeah, which was a lot of fun. Yeah, but most of the Terminator games have been pretty lousy for the most part. I mean, the NES one, the Game Boy, the Genesis versions, they've all been pretty
rough. Yeah, but of course, you know, say what you will about the NES game, but you know, it's got a Follin soundtrack. So.
Oh yeah, no, and that's the thing. Like sound wise, like that's what's so painful about some of these games is the soundtracks are so good, but the games are so bad. So it's like I can't justify playing through the game, so I'll just like download the soundtrack.
That's the beauty of PixelTunes Radio. You gotta listen to it all without having to play the crap.
Exactly.
All the fun, none of the crap.
Exactly.
That's what you get on PixelTunes Radio. So Matt Furness, I mean, we've talked about him in the past and some of the games that he's done. I mean, we've played a lot of them before. He did Zool, Mortal Kombat for the Genesis, and you know, just like tons of really good stuff.
So. Yeah, everything from Amiga to Genesis to Mega CD stuff, Atari ST, exactly. PlayStation. I mean, he's worked on all sorts of consoles.
What's really cool is he is also a pretty prolific member in terms of the current video game music crowd. So on like Facebook and all these various different groups and whatnot, he'll kind of pop in very similar to Alberto Jose Gonzalez and just be like, hey, check out this track. Like he posts on various different forums that we all belong to. And he'll just like post random tracks and be like, hey, check this out. And it's not necessarily a track that he composed. It'll just That's be like awesome. A really good track because he's, just, you know, it's cool. Like these guys are not only composers of this stuff, but they also are fans of this stuff too. So they can, you know, take a listen to a fellow composer and be like, this is really good. Everyone should check out this track, which is really cool. It's really awesome to see that. Yeah. So that's Terminator.
Yeah,
I really don't have much to say about the game because I haven't played it.
Yeah.
Music. Yeah.
It's pretty short.
Is it?
Yeah, so I was just going to say, my buddy Jason of Arthur X Jason, like, he did a Let's Play of this where he beat the game, and he did it really quick.
It was like 10 minutes long or something like that.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
So it's like Karate Kid.
If you don't know where you're going and what you're doing,
right.
it's probably, you know, a little bit longer than that.
Right.
But if you're good at the game, you know, like Contra takes like 20 minutes to beat
right.
if you know what you're doing.
No, that's true.
So this game's even a little bit more short than that if you're
yeah.
really good at it.
Yeah. I mean, I can beat Karate Kid and RoboCop in 20 minutes
yeah.
each, so.
So I think this is the one game where it's like the soundtrack is actually longer than the game.
So you can just like pause or like just let it sit on one screen.
Just let it go.
Yeah, just let it go.
Let it go.
Let it go. Oh God. Okay, so moving on. Our next game is from Capcom.
It's from Capcom.
It is from Capcom.
Okay.
It
are you
called...
giving us clues here?
No. Okay. Yeah.
It's gonna be a game.
Okay, let's do it. All right. Star is a mouse.
Street Fighter.
His name's Arthur.
Fievel's Lost Adventure.
And it involves ghosts.
UN Squadron.
All right, I'm just gonna say that. It's you're really bad at this. It's a Magical Quest starring Mickey Mouse.
That was my next guess.
Oh, okay, okay.
Okay, so, now I want to have a Street Fighter-like game with Disney characters.
Oh
somebody
my God,
get
that's
on that.
So awesome.
That has
awesome.
To happen.
Can you imagine like Goofy beating the crap out of like Mickey?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. That'd be the best.
Yes.
And like Pluto is like a summon. That'd be awesome.
We would call it Kingdom Farts.
Kingdom Farts. Oh boy. So I remember renting this game, but I don't have that much experience like playing through it. I've gotten a little far in the game, maybe like stage 4, stage 5, but I never really I never beat the game. I think I just got tired of it or whatever, and I was like, eh, whatever. But we were commenting on the soundtrack, and this track in particular is Stage 2, which is also called The Dark Forest, and obviously this game came out in the Super Nintendo, and we were saying that this track is like right out of like an unreleased Super Ghouls and Ghosts sequel, if there ever was one. And you know, there's been other Ghouls and Ghosts games before, but man, like holy crap, like this is right out of like, this is like Stage 3 of Super Ghouls and Ghosts, like the one where you're going up the spiral staircase, you
yeah,
know, that one.
Yeah,
yeah,
the similarities are inarguable.
Yeah.
And I mean, that mostly stems from the fact that Mary Yamaguchi was the main composer on this game, who
right.
also worked on Super Ghouls and Ghosts.
That's
so,
right. yeah.
same sound font, too.
Yeah.
The instruments are directly out of the
oh,
Super
absolutely.
Ghouls and Ghosts
yeah.
programming.
Yeah.
So,
same sound drivers and everything.
Yeah, so, I mean, you put the same composer with the same sound font, and you're going to get very similar sound
yeah,
to
yeah.
music.
Yeah,
pretty much.
But again, even though, and it kind of...
has its
know,
own unique feel to
right,
it.
Right, it speaks to Mary Yamaguchi's talent, where that this music also fits well in a kind of a more bright, cartoony kind of game.
Whimsy,
as well as,
if you will.
Whimsical game.
Whimsical.
You know, as well as kind of a more spooky. Spooky.
Spooky.
Spooky.
You know, super spooks and goblins. Super ghouls and goblins.
Super Mickey.
What is it called again?
Super Mickeys and Ghosts.
UN Squadron?
UN Squadron.
Super Ghouls
yes,
and Ghosts?
That, yeah,
Magical Quest starring
yep.
Mike Hecker.
Yes.
That is a game I'd play.
Wait, what
oh,
you
me
say?
Too.
I said Magical Quest starring Mike Hagar.
Oh my goodness. Yes.
You would play that?
Yes, and then
yeah.
the Japan Blockbuster exclusive Magical Quest Guy.
Magical Quest Guy edition.
I'm just yeah. totally like picturing him like suplexing that Pete spider boss at
yeah.
the end, like the second level.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
I just want to be the guy that records the voice sound effects for the Super
yeah,
Nintendo
yeah,
games.
Yeah.
It's like
yeah.
it's like you cough and they slow it down and all of a sudden it's a
yeah,
it's
yeah.
a spinning pile driver.
They just took they just took the sneeze sound effect and they just slowed it down.
Right, they just play the different keys on the keyboard.
Yeah, yeah. Unless you're Yuzo Koshiro.
This is our most digression-filled episode
yeah,
we've
yeah.
ever done. But anyways.
Unless you're Yuzo Koshiro. Because he did all the voice effects for Street
That
Street
is true.
Bone and Knuckle.
Bone and Knuckle.
Fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
All right, thanks for killing the conversation. Now I can
Sorry.
Ask Matt what he thought of this game.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, it's one of my favorite Super Nintendo games. Yeah, I owned this game back in the day. I played it a lot, beat it multiple times. Just, I always have fun playing this. I go back to it every once in a while. And actually, I probably will review it someday for Cygnus
Good, I'd love to see that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's always good when you see somebody review something that they're super passionate
mm-hmm.
about. Like, that was one of the compliments that I got from... Billy from the Game Chasers actually was, and multiple other people, not just him, when I did my Castlevania 2 review, and people were like, we can tell that you are super passionate about this game, mm-hmm, and that you've uncovered things that other people haven't. And so it's always nice to watch a review, like watching one of Matt's reviews, or watching really anybody who knows a game in and out and can really delve into it super deep.
Yeah.
And they're not just doing this just to do it. They're doing it because they love the game and they have a passion for it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Couldn't agree more.
Yeah. So
the pieces just kind of fall into place when you have that kind of a emotional contact with it.
That's what I tried to do with the Metroid Other M review, but
not so much.
wasn't as successful as I'd hoped. Oh well.
Popular opinion, Metroid.
Yeah, pretty much. Anyways, so yeah, no, I really like this game, and I agree with you that the soundtrack is very whimsy, very very happy, and just like very Disney. It strikes a chord. Yeah, like it has all the instrumentation like we've been talking about, but it's very symphonic, and I think this is when Mary Yamaguchi was going in a more symphonic direction with her tracks. She actually later on did Spawn for the Super Nintendo. Same thing. Like, that soundtrack is very orchestral, when you'd think it would be like a big action, like, you know, Japanese, like, you know.
Yeah, yeah, but
like,
it's still
like some of the stuff she did with UN Squadron, but yeah. So, and then we have Tatsuya Nishimura, who also worked on the soundtrack, right?
Yeah.
For Magical Quest?
He mostly was sound design and sound effects, so I'm not sure if he actually did any composition for this game. He did do some composition for Mega Man 7. Mega Man 7. Mm. But he was credited for BGM and sound effects for Magical Quest starring Mickey Mouse. But I'm gonna say that the majority of the soundtrack was most likely Yamaguchi, because all of it sounds,
it all sounds
so
like
much
her.
Like her.
Yeah. I will say, getting off topic a little bit, not that we're not a stranger to that. You had mentioned Nishimura working on, what was it?
Street Fighter 2?
No.
Mega Man 7?
Yeah, Mega Man 7. Mega Man 7, I kind of feel like would have really, like, I don't like the soundtrack in the sense that I don't like the arrangements. I like the compositions, I don't like the arrangements. I think that Mega Man should always stay 8-bit for the music, in my opinion. Or if you're gonna go in like a more Mega Man 8 sound, which is a little bit more jazz influenced and jazz inspired, I would say. It's a lot more laid back, low key. I think that really works for Mega Man. Yeah, I'm not a fan of the arrangements for 7 on the Super Nintendo.
Sorry to hear that.
Yeah.
I've never played it.
No?
Yeah, I don't have a lot of experience with it myself. Yeah. I think I rented it like once or twice back in the day, but that's
it's
it.
Yeah.
Don't own it. Wish I did.
Yeah.
It's
no, I agree
way expensive
you.
Now, though.
All right. So let's go ahead and get into Magical Quest starring Mike Hagar. This is Stage 2 in the Dark Forest.
Thank you.
Well, hello there, Grimace. What you doing there?
Oh, just reading a book, Ronald. Education is very important, you know.
Edgema-what? You use some crazy words sometimes, pal. You know what you need? Video games.
Video games?
Yeah, you big purple idiot. Let's check out McDonald's Treasure Land Adventure.
A short time later...
No! Go left here! Jump! I said jump! Not fall off the cliff! Get the gem! Get the f***ing gem, you moron! What the f*** are you doing, Grimace?
I'm sorry, Ronald. I have these huge hands and no fingers, and I keep pressing all six buttons at once. I guess I just wasn't cut out for video games.
It's all those f***ing books you read, Grimace. They're making you dumb. And eat a f***ing Big Mac every once in a while, huh? I bet you've never even had a heart attack before.
But Ronald, eating right and reading often are the building blocks of a healthy lifestyle.
Video games forever. Hamburgers for life. That's the way it is in McDonaldland. So either you get with the program, or... or leave forever.
I guess I know what I have to do. Goodbye, Ronald. I'll always remember you.
So long, Grimace. Hello? Is this Pizza Ninja? I'd like to order a quadruple bacon pizza with... a side of giant purple death! Welcome back. That was from Treasure Land Adventure.
McDonald's Treasure Land Adventure.
McDonald's Treasure Land Adventure.
Yes.
Not McDonald Land's Treasure Land Adventure. That'd be weird.
Right. Yeah. McDonald's Treasure Land Adventure.
That's true. And this is Stage 4, also known as Magical Moon Theme 1. I think they kind of did it where, and this came out only exclusively to the Sega Genesis.
Yes.
I think they kind of did it so that it was very similar to, I guess you could say, like Sonic. In the sense that they would have one track, and then they would have the like a remixed or faster version of the track as the second part.
Version 2 is basically a sped up version of the same song.
Right, right. But I kind of like the slower version.
Me too. I prefer the slower one as well.
Yeah. Now you reviewed this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So tell us what your experience is with this game. I mean, aside from reviewing it.
Well, I mean, yeah, this is a game. I mean, and there's been a few of them in my channel. Like, it's one that I found at one of my local shops. I just took a chance of it. I was like, it's a McDonald's game.
Why
even
not?
If it's crap, you know, like most people consider crap, you know, it's got, I'm sure there's something there worthwhile that I could say in the review. And then lo and behold, it's a really good game, you know? And then I find out that it's, you know, made by Treasure. So I was like, well, there you go. That's why it's a good game.
That's
exactly.
The reason.
Exactly.
My favorite part of your review, Matt, was the whole explanation of why Ronald McDonald is psychotic.
Yeah, exactly.
Jumping on ballerina heads.
Oh, yeah. He's metal.
There's a really weird, trippy parts in this game.
Yeah, yeah.
And Treasure did that a lot.
Oh, there really are. Yeah.
Especially like in a lot of the games that never came out in the U.S. that Treasure did, like Alien Soldier. It's just there's a lot of really bizarre, and even in like Contra Hardcore and Gunstar Heroes, just really creative, super bizarre bosses and situations that the characters get themselves into, and McDonald's Treasure Land Adventure is no different.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Treasure wanted to take things to the next level, and I don't think they had the chance to when they were with Konami, like when they were working with Konami. I think they kind of were starting to go in that direction, but they really went pretty insane in terms of game direction and game design and everything. And I think it was for the better, in my opinion. I think the games were more original, the games were more unique. So Treasure is a great company.
Absolutely.
My theory on why this game is so good is that Treasure was contacted by McDonald's to make a video game. And Treasure was like, okay, that's cool. How much money do you want to give us to make this video game? And McDonald's, being the huge corporation that they are, is like, well, we can only give you $70 billion to make this video game. And Treasure was like, Well, that might be enough to do it. That's why the game is so awesome.
That's not what happened.
They just had... I'm exaggerating the dollar amount.
No.
But I'm saying it seems like McDonald's threw a lot of money at this game because it's extremely well done.
That's not what happened. Here's what happened.
Oh.
What happened was they were in a contract with Virgin Games, and Global Gladiators was just that good, and the soundtrack just blew McDonald's CEO away so hard that they were like, we need to see a top-notch startup company attempt to try to get to the level of Global Gladiators. And so they were like, Treasure, what up? Listen, we're gonna give you a couple hundred dollars. All right, we gave Tommy Tallarico a couple burgers. All right, that was his payment. We need you to make an amazing McDonald game. Okay, can you do it? And they were like, oh yes, we can do it. And they did it, and it was a pretty good game, but the CEO did not rocket out of his chair listening to the music. The music was good, but I don't know, Global Gladiators, man. Mm.
Okay, so I take back the Ronald McDonald was psychotic comment and apply it to Mike.
There we go.
This moon theme is
really funky.
It's one of my favorite Genesis tunes.
Yeah, it's a good track.
It's really significant because,
it's one of my favorites, too.
The Sega Genesis has a, and I'll get a little geeky here.
Oh boy.
I've said it, a million times before. It's got the YM2612FM synthesizer chip in it, which also has a digital audio channel that you can use for white noise and drums and stuff like that. But then it also has the Sega PSG chip. The Sega PSG chip is identical to the entire music chip that the Sega Master System had. So, and it's only purpose being there was that for Sega Master System backwards compatibility.
Right.
Although some games used it specifically for percussion. Mm-hmm. This track sounds really unique among Genesis songs for the most part because it actually used that PSG chip for melody and harmony alongside FM. So it's really, really rare that you get wavetable music alongside FM music at the same time.
Right.
I can think of very, very few games. Sonic 3 had it just a little bit, and I think RoboCop 3, the arcade game, had a PSG and an FM chip in it. And this is literally the third song I've ever heard ever that uses the PSG and the FM at the same time. And I know that's geeky, but it's kind of significant.
No, that's cool.
And historical.
Pretty cool.
It gives that song, it's really unique. Those little bleeps and bloops in the background and that kind of scratchy FM noise is actually the wavetable and FM together making that unique sound.
That's
so
cool.
These guys really knew what they were doing because they could make both chips work in tandem together and do both the percussion and the melody at the same time. So kind of blew me away.
Yeah, one of the things I will say about Treasure is they really knew how to exploit the Genesis hardware, and that was actually, I've read interviews with Treasure, and they specifically stated they will always hands down pick the Genesis over the Super Nintendo to make games because they could get so much more out of the Genesis than they could. And I'm not saying that I think that the Super Nintendo, you can't get anything out of it. That's totally not true because there were some unbelievable things that happened on the Super Nintendo. But I think that with the Genesis, due to the faster processor, I think that game developers were able to get so much more out of the Genesis versus the Super Nintendo. So as far as the composers go, there were two composers of this track. Katsuhiko Suzuki, who I guess goes under the name Nazo Suzuki as well, was a big-time Konami employee, worked under some of the earlier Poppin' Music games. Ended up getting defaulted over to Treasure, much like very many of the Konami video game developers. A lot of people just kind of peaced out and went to Treasure. So he's done a lot of stuff with Dance Dance Revolution. He did Roller Games, which actually has a really good soundtrack as well.
I think we played that track on the Aaron Hickman episode.
Yeah,
these games.
So. Yeah. No, Roller Games came out. Am I thinking of the right game?
Oh.
That's
you're
skating
right.
Game.
I'm thinking
that's
of the other roller skating game, or the other roller skating game.
Yeah.
We mentioned Roller Games on that,
right.
On that episode.
That's correct, yeah. Roller Games, though, had a great soundtrack. He worked on Dynamite Heady, Light Crusader, Guardian Heroes on the Saturn, Silhouette Mirage on the Saturn, and the last track he did was the Gradius Arcade soundtrack, which I guess there was a Gradius Arcade game that came out in 2002.
So here's the deal, and I'm just finding this out.
Yeah.
Suzuki also worked on Lagrange Point,
Okay.
For the NES.
Right.
That game used the Konami VRC7 chip.
Okay.
Which was an FM chip.
Right.
So that also used the wavetable synth from the NES and the FM together. Uh-huh. It's probably where he got the expertise to be able to do it on
that
the
makes sense. Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah, detective work.
Detective work. Mm-hmm. You're a regular Batman of video game nerddom.
You're my Robin.
Hey, I want to be Batman.
You're my Catwoman.
All right. Well, there you go. Meow. Anyways, other composer was Satoshi Murata. Worked on a bunch of really fast, super crazy arcade games. Didn't really stick directly with Treasure. I mean, he worked on Bengayo, Bengayo Spirits, Bengayo HD Missile Fury, Astro Boy, Omega Factor, which was a great Game Boy Advance game.
All these top-notch Treasure games.
Oh, fantastic stuff. Ikaruga, which was a great shooter. Stretch Panic, which was a really underappreciated PlayStation 2 game. Really weird game.
Yep.
Worked on Radiant Silver Gun, Sin and Punishment, which was an awesome N64 exclusive, and Dynamite Heady, as well as Goof Troop, which was a Capcom game.
Yes.
So he didn't really stick with a bunch, with like a specific set of developers. He kind of roamed around after he, I'm sure he started with Konami, similar to these other guys, and then, you know, left, but there's not really that much background on him.
So McDonald's Treasureland Adventure also has the distinction of having the dumbest ending ever.
I don't know. Global Gladiator's ending was pretty dumb.
Yeah, it is pretty dumb.
Do you want to explain why it's so dumb, Matt?
I mean, sure, I can sum it up. I mean, pretty much it starts off with Ronald McDonald finding this piece of this map or whatever for this treasure, and then over the course of his journey, he gets all the pieces for the map, and then it takes them to the moon, and then he, you know, finds the treasure and confronts, like the last boss is like the keeper of the treasure or whatever. And
like this little slug thing.
Yeah, he's cute, though. And he, like, after you beat him, he, like, lays his, like, sob story or whatever, and starts crying or whatever, and then Ronald, like, oh, we'll let you have it then. We're going to head back, you know.
We're not going to take your treasure anyway.
What?
That's the ending.
That's pretty weak.
And then they just go back to Earth.
Yep. That's pretty bad.
Yeah, they trip balls nothing, all the way back there.
Yeah, there's no character development, there's no gain.
Because they do like the no this like rainbow, if I remember right, it's kind of like this rainbow bridge or whatever. It's like so weird.
Royal Rainbow!
It is just bizarre.
Global Gladiators has a pretty bad ending too. I mean, you
know if I've ever seen it.
Well, you come out of you saw my review, how you go into the comic book world or whatever.
And yeah.
You're basically a global gladiator and you're trying to save, I don't know, recycle, basically. And, so when you beat the game, you beat this monster, there's no conversation whatsoever about this giant ice monster, and apparently he's the main bad guy. So you beat him, and then you come out of the comic book, and Ronald McDonald's there, and he's like, you know, the two kids, Mick and Mac, are like, oh, was it real? And then Ronald's like, maybe, and puts up like an M, like a McDonald's arch M. And you're just like, really? That's the end?
See, at least two kids got to meet Ronald McDonald at the end of the game.
Yeah, there you go.
Ronald can't beat himself. I mean, he's already himself, so.
Yeah, true.
I guess that's what ties those McDonald's games together. You know, pretty bad endings. Yeah, I don't know about MC Kids or Mick Kids. I don't know. I've never beaten that game, so I don't know what the ending for that's like.
I'm sure it's like
probably
Ronald.
Oh, it probably is.
I don't know, peas in somebody's coffee or something. I don't know. Something like that.
Yeah.
Moving on. Our next game is Streets of Rage 2, which is a classic Yuzo Koshiro's soundtrack.
Oh yeah. Oh, yeah. Hell yeah.
This is Stage 3, which is the alien lair. Also, the track is called Alien Power. This is my least favorite track on the soundtrack, but...
Oh, it's my favorite.
It is, really. It's your favorite.
I like it a lot, too.
I do.
It's a good track. I'm not saying it's like a bad track. It's just, it's my least favorite of the soundtrack.
Fair enough.
And I also just hate this level. I don't know why. I think it's because I hate the alien. I always punch the alien in the face. I'm like,
that's
I
pretty
hate
much
you.
What he's meant to do.
I hate you.
So, alien. Like, you're Will Smith in '94?
Yeah.
Basically.
I'm just like, I hate you, alien. Die.
Cigar hanging out of your mouth.
Yeah, and I just punch him in the face. I'm like, you stupid face, alien. Dumb face.
All right.
Yeah. That's how it goes.
Now that we've got that out of the way.
Yeah, it's exactly like that.
Aside from picking this track because it's your favorite, what was your inspiration for picking Streets of Rage 2? Because I know, if I recall, I think you reviewed all three Streets of Rage games, didn't you?
I did.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes.
So, yep. I gotta ask, Streets of Rage or Final Fight for you?
Okay. Wait a minute.
Streets of Fire.
When you say Streets of Rage, are you talking the franchise or just the original
the franchise.
Game?
So okay. Streets of Rage franchise versus Final Fight franchise, which do you prefer? Mm.
That's... Now, maybe that's not fair because I haven't really played Final Fight 3, so I can't. Okay. And I haven't really played a ton of Final Fight 2 either.
Yeah, you're not mentioning much.
But of what I have experienced of it, I would have to give it to Streets of Rage.
Yeah, I think Streets of Rage is the better series. I got to agree.
Yeah. Because I was going to say, yeah. If you're talking about Streets of Rage 1 versus
right.
Final Fight,
yeah.
the original,
yeah.
well then...
No, I got to agree there. I think the first Final Fight is so good.
Yes.
But the sequels just don't live mm-hmm. up to the first game.
I disagree.
Really?
I really like the sequels.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe I found something in them that other people haven't. But I think the letterboxing of the games takes a lot of people. Like, a lot of people complain about that for some reason. It's that, like, at the time where, you know, Capcom was trying to squeeze more power out of the system by throwing less pixels up on the screen.
True.
So they kind of squished the resolution a little bit. But yeah. I think, I don't know, yeah. I think it felt a lot like the original Final Fight, and they had those special moves and the storyline, and you just kind of enhanced the original Final Fight.
My big problem was, I think, jumping from Final Fight 1 on the Super NES to jumping to Final Fight 2 and 3 later on, the sprites were smaller, the sound was completely different. I mean, you had more of like a soundtrack that was, that sounded a lot... less
like,
beefy.
It had that Konami overdriven guitar tinny sound.
Yeah, it was very tinny. It was very like overdriven Capcom sound that just didn't sound good. And the first Final Fight game just was so, like the soundtrack on the Super Nintendo specifically is my favorite. And just has, it's so rich and punchy and vibrant.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, I mean I played the arcade Final Fight after I played the Super Nintendo one, and then going like hearing that after hearing the original, I don't know if it's nostalgia or whatnot.
I totally agree with you. The Super Nintendo version does shine way above the FM original FM arcade version.
Yeah,
the X68000 version actually is a little bit better because it uses a more of an enhanced FM chip. Plus, it has a more I use that word again beefy PCM chip with much stronger percussion. So,
Who cares about the percussion, man? Those freaking horns.
You know me; it's the percussion. It's
I love percussion. I love drums. I'm just saying.
Well, yeah, like Toilet Gang, like the French horns just, make that song.
Yeah, yeah. No, I
but don't. We're not talking about Final Fight here. We're talking about
Streets of Rage. I know. I just had to ask the question. So, Streets of Rage 2.
Yes.
All the soundtracks are phenomenal by Yuzo Koshiro. So you definitely picked a great game and a great soundtrack. I mean, it's one of the most iconic soundtracks in video games, specifically for the Sega Genesis, I would say.
Absolutely. Yep, my favorite Genesis game and my favorite beat 'em up, actually.
Nice. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I really like the first Streets of Rage as well. And then Streets of Rage 3 I've never played, so...
Yeah.
Well, Streets of Rage, the original, is definitely a good game.
Yeah.
But in comparison to the original Final Fight, yeah, the original Final Fight's better.
Yeah, no.
I think.
Yeah.
I mean, even I'll say that as
a
Genesis guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll kind of agree. I don't agree as strongly as Mike does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I just don't like the implement... I don't like... I appreciate it, I guess, but the special in the first game where it's like you call on the assist from the car, with the bazooka or whatever. I don't like that as much.
It slows.
And then
the game
and once you get into like the last level when you're in the headquarters or whatever, you know, for the final, you're making your way to the final boss, Mr. X. You can't use that because you're way up your however many stories up, you know. So yeah, it's kind of worthless, you know.
Yeah,
you know, it's inevitable. Every time I play Streets of Rage, regardless of how long it's been since I've played last, I start the game.
I know where you're going with this.
I walk up to the first guy, I hit special button by accident.
Every single
time.
Yep. It happens to all of us.
I'm like, overkill the first guy. It's just like a tradition now.
You're teaching him a lesson. You're sending a message to all his buddies.
This is what I'm going
to
do to all of you. And the rest of the guys should run, but no, they want to punch you anyway.
Yeah.
It's like, I've got a cop with a bazooka 30 feet behind me. What are you doing?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, boy.
So let's get into the music.
Yeah.
This is Alien Lair, Streets of Rage 2, from one of our favorites, Yuzo Koshiro. We're throwing out the big guns tonight, composer-wise, man.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Let's give it a listen. ¶¶
Welcome back. That was our last track of the day, and that was Bucky O'Hare, and that was the ending theme one from the 1992 NES game. And I really like that track, and it's a perfect ending track. It's just a really good closer, and it just, I really like how the track just kind of has this "you did it" kind of vibe.
You did it!
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Except not so much.
Oh yeah, you really feel accomplished when you hear that.
Yeah, no, and I think that's exactly.
And rightfully so, because that's a pretty hard game.
Yeah, no, definitely. Yeah, it's a tough game, and you've reviewed this one as well.
I did. And it was my first ever review.
Yep, your review was the way that I found out that there was a Bucky O'Hare. Like, I knew of the game, but I didn't know how good it was. I then had to, of course, add it to my collection, and I'm glad I did.
Absolutely. Well, I'm glad that I could lead you to that.
Yeah, no, it's a great game.
Show you how awesome it is.
Seriously.
And it is amazing.
Price on this game is jumping. Pretty crazy.
Yeah, sadly. I mean, I wish everybody could play it, you know. But yeah, it's gone up since like the 10 that I got it for.
Yeah,
you know?
I got it for, I think, 30, and that was a good deal I got it. Because I only got it like maybe 2 years ago or so. So now I think it's like a $60 game, something like that.
Wow. Yeah, if not more. It could be more.
It could be, yeah. So Bucky O'Hare, of course, is the game is based on the cartoon series and the toy series, basically.
And the comic.
Yeah, and the comic. Basically, Ninja Turtles was big back then, so they were trying to duplicate the Ninja Turtles' success. So Bucky O'Hare was one of the many incarnations of
Anthropomorphic heroes,
right. I remember when I was younger, I used to always get Bucky O'Hare and Usagi Yojimbo confused.
Yeah, they're kind of similar. I mean, they're both rabbits.
They're both rabbits.
I could see that, yeah.
And I always thought, like, Usagi Yojimbo went off to space and now he's rescuing.
Now he's green.
Now he's green, yeah.
So. Yep.
Died to scan and gave up samurai. this samurai world.
Yes.
So, but yeah, this game, why don't you tell us a little bit about the game since you reviewed it?
Sure. I mean, it's, you know, it's a platformer. It's from Konami. It's actually my favorite NES game. A lot of people said it's like a Mega Man ripoff or whatever, since, you know, it's not linear. You could choose what world you want to go to, but, you know, I actually enjoy it more than most Mega Mans, you know?
People just say that because, you know, it's a jumpy, shooty game, so.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think the
but there's so many
similar
of those on the NES, so.
Yeah. Now, if I recall, there's different planets that you mm-hmm. go to, and basically the whole point of the game is you start off as Bucky O'Hare, your team got captured, mm-hmm. and so you're basically going from planet to planet saving them, and once you save yep. one, you can then play as that character, and each character has exactly. like different abilities. It's yes. kind of like the Samurai Pizza Cats game that came out in Japan only, and it's kind of the same, like when you get one of your like little sidekick buddies, they all have different abilities, and you can use their abilities to get to different yep. places and certain locations. So very cool.
Exactly.
Yes. And all the planets have very original names, like Red Planet, and Blue Planet,
yeah. Yeah,
and
Blue Planet, and Green Planet.
Like, come on, guys, get a little more original here. I mean, if they can do it for Space Area, you can do it for right. O'Hare.
Yeah.
Good point.
So
still, the game's amazing. Yes. So, yeah. Regardless of that,
most of the soundtrack is Japanese arcade action-y, mostly rock or dance based.
Very Konami sounding.
Very Konami.
It's got the Konami percussion in the background.
Definitely does, yeah. But this last track is very symphonic. It's very orchestral and very, you know, as I said before, very much like a "you did it, congratulations" sort of mm-hmm. a vibe, which is really good.
Kind of reminds me of, I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, but the soundtrack to Track and Field 2, also by Konami. It sounds very similar to
does
that.
Does it? Yeah.
Okay.
Just very kind of anthem-y. Track and Field 2 is obviously like based on the Olympics, so it had a lot of those kind of stadium-style, triumphant kind of sounding songs, and this really sounds similar to that to me. It was composed by Tomoko Sumiyama, and she didn't work on too much. She worked primarily with Konami. She started off with Esper Dream, which was a Famicom Disk System release in 1987.
Is it an RPG?
Esper Dream, I believe so.
I think it's an RPG, yeah.
Laser Invasion, which came out in the US for the NES. Base Wars, which had a pretty good soundtrack.
That was the
baseball
game. That was the cyborg baseball game?
Yes.
Yep, okay. That's
yep.
the one.
Yep.
And then the version of Rampart, which only came out for the Famicom in 91. And then she worked on Bucky O'Hare in 92, and that was the last we heard of her.
Gotcha.
So she's probably become a ninja at this point.
It's a shame.
Probably a pretty good ninja, because she hasn't come back to work since then, so.
Yeah. It's true, I guess. Maybe she works for Pizza Ninja.
It's true.
Yeah, there you go.
It's true.
Exactly.
Still have to find out who attempted that hit on us last episode.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy. All right, so that's going to do it for our episode. You can listen to this podcast at PixelTunesRadio.com. Check us out on iTunes as well. We're also available on Stitcher. You can also check out a video version of the podcast where you can basically see still images of the games that we play, so that way you can kind of scroll through on YouTube and be like, oh, where's the track? Oh, I want to go back to that track. So it's really cool. You can check that out at youtube.com/dongled. All right, Matt, so where can we find you on the interwebs?
First and foremost is the YouTube channel. So that's Cygnus Destroyer 20XX altogether. But if you just want to do a search for Cygnus Destroyer or just do LJN Defender, you'll find me. But I mean, I'm on Twitter at Cygnus Destroyer, facebook.com/Cygnus Destroyer. That's pretty much everything, yeah.
And we'll put all those links up on our Facebook group as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Speaking of our Facebook group, you can find us at facebook.com/groups/PixelTunesRadio.
That's right.
And that's where we basically post most of our stuff. Any bonus content that you'll find from the podcasts will be up there. We'll obviously have a link to Matt's stuff as LJN Defender. And, I want to call you, for the Innocent Until Proven Guilty segments, I want to call you Judge Retro, because I think that just sounds so
okay.
cool.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
I like it. That's a good title.
So yeah. That's what I'm going to call you, even Judge if you don't call Retro. Yourself that.
Yeah.
Judge Retro.
Yeah, I like it. I approve of that.
And so you can check his stuff out there. And then...
And I will add something I forgot before. I will do a plug for Multitap.com. Multitapped is a group. It's a group of YouTubers. We decided to form a thing, and we have a website. And sometimes there's collaborations, but it's just right now. It's pretty much just a home for our content. And we do some challenges every now and then. We have like a Tetris challenge on there right now, and I think there's a Chippendale Rescue Rangers challenge that's going to go up sometime.
Sweet.
So yeah, multitap.com.
Yeah,
check that out.
Multitap's really cool. They I know a bunch of the guys on there too, and they do a lot of really fun videos. They did this one. collaboration video before it was multi-tapped, where they did, I can't say the name of it because it's a swear, but basically
the
it rhymes with...
The 3DO music video.
Yes, the 3DO music video, and it's basically like, we don't like the 3DO. Let's just put it that way.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. But it is a riot. It's pretty ridiculous and very silly.
I'll
so
check that out.
We'll definitely post that. To
Benny and Jason, they did it. That was all them.
Yeah,
they did
them.
A great job.
Yeah,
of that.
They did a great job. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah. Jason did the tune. Benny did the editing.
I figured Jason did the tune because he's super talented when it comes to music. Yep. So yeah.
Awesome.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
So similar to Multitapped, we are on the Retro Junkies Network.
That's right.
And you can look them up just by typing Retro Junkies into your Facebook search bar.
Tons of great podcasts.
Yeah, Genesis Gems, the SNES podcast.
Two guys and an NES.
Two dudes and an S.
That's right.
Two dudes and an S. And there's just so many good, like, just basically talk retro podcasts on that network. So you can also just search Retro Junkies feed on iTunes, and that will basically give you one feed with all of the Retro Junkies Network shows in it at once. So if you just want a good smattering of retro goodness that covers almost every single system you can think of, from Intellivision all the way up to, you know, like PlayStation, you can get a lot of good stuff there.
Definitely.
Including us, we'll also show up on that feed.
It's true, it's true. Yeah, it was a real pleasure having you on, Matt. Thanks a lot for joining us. I know we've been talking about doing this for a very, very long time.
For almost a year, I
think. Yeah, almost a year.
Yeah.
But we're glad to have you on, and we'd love to have you back in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. I definitely would. I had a lot of fun. Yeah. You know, I mean, I listen to every episode. Oh, and I forgot to mention before, like on the other one about the Bionic Commando.
Yes.
I got to disagree with you, Ed, about that. I don't like the rearmed version.
Oh, snap.
You know? No.
Yes, that's okay.
No.
That's
it doesn't do it for me.
Because I know you're a classic guy, so I can totally understand.
Yeah, that's probably why. Yeah.
He's with me.
I fully admit that's probably. I guess I'm biased that
way. That doesn't sway my opinion. No offense.
And that's fine.
So stay tuned. In 2 weeks, we'll be back, and we're signing off for now.
Once again, thanks for being on the show, Matt.
You're welcome. It's all good. I had a blast.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right. See you in 2 weeks, boys and girls.
All right. Peace out, kids.
Later.